Hello everybody, I'm Shanta Sinha. I work as the professor in the Department of Political Science, University of Hyderabad. I also serve the National Commission for Protection of Child Rights. Today I'm going to talk to you in the capacity of being a child rights activist, working over four decades for rights of children and to see that children actually go to school. I'd like to talk to you about, especially about adolescent girls and their right to education, and the kinds of challenges they have faced in getting into schools, especially high schools and beyond. I want to start with a small story today. You know, this is a story that has always inspired me, and perhaps I owe a lot to what I'm doing today to what had happened about 30 years ago. This was about a girl, Indira, who had in fact lived about 10 kilometers away from our local office. We were working on getting children to school. That morning at about 7 o'clock, I found this 11-year-old girl who came, and she said that, look, I'm getting married and it's your duty now, please stop my marriage. I was kind of taken aback because I thought she was too young and she should not have run away from home. So I told her, look, get back home. It's not safe for you to be away from your parents, be away from your home. Let's see what we can do. Then she pulled me up and she said that if you're not able to rescue me, if you're not able to save me, then why are you running this organization for children's rights? I heard so much about you and now you tell me to get back home. 7 times I fought my marriage and I saved myself, but this time I can do no more. And if you don't, close down your organization. An 11-year-old girl questioning me if I really cared for children and cared for girls. That was something that was an eye-opener, and I felt that I have to sort of rescue her. Even if she was away from home, she had to be saved, because if home was not her safe place, somewhere she was not safe with her own parents, with her own family. And that's how began my work on girls, girls' education and gender discrimination. I started looking at what was the life of girls in those areas. What is it that or takes them to do what they did, like I talked about this girl, Indira. And what was her daily routine? And that is getting into details. And I found that from the time of her born, given servitude in total submission, and she has to listen to whoever there is, not answer back, not question. And she had to play the role to prepare herself to become a mother and to become a laborer. So she did all the domestic work. Narrate the domestic work she did. It sounds monotonous. And it sounds monotonous even when you're reading about it, that she fetches water, she fetches fuel wood, she cooks, she sweeps the floor, she washes utensils, she washes clothes, she's the last one to eat and she's malnourished. You know, the list goes on. But it is this list, this deadly monotony of her life that is with her, not just for that moment, till she dies, till she becomes a wife, till she becomes a mother, till she becomes a grandmother. She's only doing this alone. She has no dreams. She has nothing before her. And I felt that, look, this cannot be the life of a girl. It has to change. And that is when we felt that we will have to somewhere look at girls' lives and recognize them. Not say this monotonous thing, she does this, and then keep quiet. It is forgotten that she is a sensuous human being with a life, with a dream of her own, and she wants to live like any other child. And we start speaking to girls, and we found that these girls, some of them, are looking at girls going to school. They're wearing a school uniform, and they wonder, when will my turn come? Will I ever go to school? You know, that is the kind of a question they keep asking for themselves. If this is when we felt that we have to now change reality for these girls. And we found that there are so many who are changing reality for these girls. And they do have support structures. They do have people who support them. But we have to enhance these support structures. We have to tell them that, look, these girls are aspiring for education. But only education alone, we found, would not solve the problem. If we did not tackle the issue of gender discrimination, if we did not talk about gender equality, if we did not talk about how boys are treated and how girls are treated and how it is considered as a norm, then there's not much that we can do. So there has to be a change in mindsets. There has to be a change in social norms. And that is what we started doing. And that is what many are doing now. And when you're saying you change mindsets, it's not just talking to the girls. Yes, of course, talking to girls is important. Organizing them to girls' committees, empowering them, telling them about their rights, all that is important. But we should talk to boys as well. We should talk to men as well, because they're as much part of the problem and they have to become part of the solution. And here, we are not taking any adversarial role against the boys or the men. We are not saying that it is because of you this is happening. We are saying all this is happening because there is a patriarchy, because there is an ideology that justifies gender inequality, because there is an ideology that makes a child so submissive that she is condemned for good. So in a way, we had to build partnerships with more and more people around, boys and girls. And here one important thing I must say, in the villages, when you say youth must come together, it's always the boys, the Dalit groups, the Ambedkar groups, the Adivasi groups. The image of a youth is a youth of a boy. So we said, no, girls are also youth, but they're not allowed to be youth because they're married even before they get youth. You know, they skip the stage of youthfulness. From a child, they become an adult. There is no adolescence. There's no youth in their lives. So we have to do something about it. So we said, boys and girls must come together in common clubs, and boys must learn to accept girls as equals. That is when girls started coming together, opening up, and they started hoisting the flag, asking the Gram Panchayat, give us the right to hoist a flag. And we wondered, why do you want a flag now? They said, no, it is this flag that is going to protect me. I have been told there is a constitution that is going to give me an equal right. This is not what we told the girls. They themselves said, we have to participate in hoisting the flag and we have to be equal to boys. The boys will make all the arrangements, but when there is a Village Independence Day program, it is a girl who will hoist the flags. That was again a huge eye-opener for us. So, you know, things started changing. It was not easy. Let me tell you, every act of a girl is an act of resolving conflicts. It's not a smooth program. It's not a spoke program where say there is an announcement, let us have a Beti Bachao program, save girls program. You can't save a girl without resolving a conflict. There's a power dynamics in it. In every family, there's a power dynamics in it. Every location where the girl is, it's a contentious issue. In a bus stop, there's a contention. In a school, there's a contention. In a college, there's a contention. These are operate in very subtle manners. These are issues of conflict. That there is no toilet in a school is an issue of conflict. That there is no room where girls can sit when they are in schools is an issue of conflict. That teachers, without knowing, discriminate girls and boys is an issue of conflict. That a married girl is not allowed to get back to study because she is married is an issue of conflict. So we said, look, this is not a soft program. Getting girls their rights and their assertions is a program of empowering girls and resolving conflicts. But we don't want to make it a battleground. It is a process of resolving conflicts that you build alliances, that you build networks, you get people to come together and to help girls study. You know what we found about girls then? When they knew there are voices in their support, they started defying everything in the family. And they said, now we are going to study. But what was their act of defiance? How did they do it? Very interesting. Their act of defiance are the weapons they already had. They sulked, they cried, they didn't comb their hair. They said, we will not cook today. And they went on Maunavrat. They said, silence, they're not talking to anyone. So, you know, they didn't have to have violent responses. The weapons they had, they became so inconvenient that the adults had to say, now you go and study. We know that you are so determined about it. Just go to school. Just study high school. Just go beyond high school. So somewhere, the girls' weapons became very strong. And what gave them the strength? Some voices here and there in their support. And anchoring on a ray of hope, they knew that there are people who are talking about me and my right. So now I can do more. So that is the inner power of the girl. You know, we do talk about girls' power. When they know there are voices around, they assert. And no journey of these girls to school has been without a conflict, without resolving conflict, without their assertion, without their empowerment. And they've all gone to school. So we were very, very happy about it, that girls are fighting, they're battling in a non-violent manner, people are supporting them. And now their parents stopped asking, when are you going to get married? They ask new questions. What will you do after your 11th grade? What will you do after your 12th? Will you go to college? Which college? Where is the hostel? Is it safe to be in a hostel? You know, very new questions. It's not what is about dowry. It is not what is about who will give what gift. It is not about how many saris we give, how many jewelry we give. It's about totally new questions. You know, this is remarkable, the kind of changes that occurred. And we felt that these girls have taken a historic decision in their lives to say no to their horrible past and to get back to education. And they defied everything to study. And they were the ones who are paving the way for future generations of girls in the country. It looked so good, you know, the whole thing. But then what happened was COVID. You know, and here I think the tragedies really began. In the beginning, yes, boys, girls, mother, family in rural India, they were all get together. First time they were discovering a family, they were all in the same house in the lockdown. Girls came back from hostels, boys came back from hostels. They're all together. Sometimes even they played indoor games. But within a 2 or 3 week time, they found that they had no work to do. The schools closed, the hostels closed. They didn't know where to go. And there was no livelihood. There was hunger. And tensions began. Scarcity of food. Who gets more food? Who gets less food? Even when you have to wash your hands, you know, the limited access to soap. Who gets more soap? Who gets less soap? There was limited, some of the girls had limited access to sanitary pads. They didn't have money to buy sanitary pads. So these kinds of tensions blew up, and anxieties among girls especially. They worked so hard to be in 9th class, 10th class, 11th class, 12th class, and their dreams, their aspirations, all of a sudden crumbled. They fought, I told you, to come up to the stage, and somewhere all that began a kind of a wasted battle, and they're again back to square one. So did all the things that one did all the fights that they did come to a naught? Was it reversed? These were the questions that bother us at the moment. Now these girls are going to work. There's child labor rampant. You find that they're going to cotton fields, they're going to chili farms, they're again going back to farm work, they're working on their own farms, they're going to take care of their sisters' children. It looks like there is a rewind of everything. They've come back to the originality, in the original position, and the girls just don't like it. You know, and what do you do with it? In this context, I must tell you, just day before yesterday, I had a conversation with a girl on a Zoom meeting to find out what she was doing. She was holding a big stick. She was in a farm and she was plucking limes in a huge lemon farm, you know. And I asked her, look, you're talking on the Zoom. Where did you get this telephone from? Did your parents allow you to use your phone? Very interesting. She said, no. Last time when we had the COVID break, we worked hard. I saved 10,000 rupees and I bought a cell phone for myself because I wanted to continue with the online classes. I wanted my own telephone. I said, is it only you or are there other girls also who did it? She said, yes, many of my classmates worked hard to get a telephone. And we're all using these telephones to look at, to study further. We want to continue further. We don't want to give up on education. We earn enough for the family, but we want to continue. One way it was a success story. On the other hand, I said, how sad it is for this girl that to hold on to her dreams, she has to do double things, you know. And then I told her, look, is it okay for you to talk to me on the Zoom now? You're working, you know. What will your supervisor tell? She said, no, I told my supervisor that I have a Zoom call and I have to talk, and he allowed me for this. So look at the empowerment these girls have, you know, look how strong they are and how much they aspire for education. And this is where I think that we will have to support girls. Now, you might ask me, then what must we do to support these girls? You know, what is it that we must do? First of all, they cannot be forced to work. Secondly, they cannot be forced to get married. Many of these girls are getting married. You know, because parents feel that it is not safe for a child to be alone. So you find that many, many of them are getting married and girls are resisting, but they're not able to win their battles for them. And they're being pushed into marriage. They try their best through childline, through others, but it seems they're failing in that. And that is where I think it is so important that we bring posters, we bring literature, we bring banners, we make announcements saying that it is against law for a girl to get married. And it's simply no. And again, there has to be the local functionaries, the higher level officials, all of them have to talk against child marriage. You know, somewhere we thought that patriarchy is default. It's a default value. And it comes back like a monster again and again. And that has to go. It has to go forever. Girls will have to be given a chance. And they will fight. When they are fighting, we have to be with them. We have to see that they win their battles for education. And this is just not a transformation in their lives and their families. I can assure you it will transform your life, my life. It will make our country a better country. And it will really deepen democracy in our country. So I think it is so important that we talk about girls' education, but not talk about girls' education in isolation. Every time we talk about girls' education, we have to talk about gender discrimination and make it easy for girls to go to school and see that their aspiration for education is fulfilled. It requires all of us, energy from all of us for the entire nation at a national level, at a local level. We have to say the right script and practice the right things to see that girls are protected and they go to school. Thank you very much. Thank you very much for listening to me. And I do hope that we have a fruitful discussion based on what I have just said. Thanks a lot.